Good to be with you. By the way, we are trying to turn the air down a little bit. It's kind of, I've been laughing this morning saying, you can tell by my hair that it's like total humidity in Little Rock this morning. But we're glad to be here. We're glad to be in our cozy New Heights worship, and we're glad that you're at Pulaski Heights worshiping with us this morning. I'm Reverend Betsy Snyder, pastor of Preaching and Mission, and just want to welcome you at this time, especially if you're new to this service, and invite you to tear off your Registration Connect card. If you will, please fill that out. Take note inside of the opportunities that we have for youth, children, adults, a lot of ministries kicking up for the summer, new studies, different things that I think that you would be interested in. We encourage you to look at that. And we've got a brand new sermon series I'm really excited about this morning. It's inspired by the Arkansas Repertory Theater's Godspell, which some of you have told me you've already seen and loved. I'm seeing it with my family this afternoon at the matinee, and so we are really excited about this. The subtitle of the series is A Broadway Parable, and today's sermon is based on a parable from Luke, called The Unjust Judge and the Widow. And the title of our sermon today is How Long Should We Wait for Justice? At the same time, I also want to take note that it is Pentecost Sunday, the birthday of the church. And so we are glad to celebrate that as well today. Will you stand and prepare for the greeting as Reverend Hampton leads us?
Thank you. you sing that chorus with us? You are the everlasting God. Come on.
You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. For the defender of the weak, you comfort those in need. You lift us up only.
Forever. He lives forever. He lasts forever. And what that means is that God will outlast any of the negative circumstances that are in your life. I had one of my friends ask me earlier this week, he said, if God's real, if he's always here, why do I have to go through these tough times in my life? Why do people get sick and why do catastrophes happen? And you know, the reality of it is that we live in a world where there are laws. And certain things happen that we don't have control over. And there are cells in our body that go rogue sometime and we get sick. The beauty of knowing that God is with us in our lives is that whether we're in the highest heights or the lowest of lows, we're never in it by ourselves. He's always with us. And he loved us so much that he gave us a reminder of his presence with us. And as we celebrate Pentecost Sunday today, I'd just like to invite you to re-invite the Holy Spirit into your life.
Be or a reading from Luke chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. Jesus was telling them a parable about their need to pray continuously and not be discouraged. He said, "In a certain city, there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected people. In that city, there was a widow who kept coming to him asking, 'Give me justice in this case against my adversary.' For a while, he refused, but finally said to himself, 'I don't fear God or respect people, but I will give this widow justice because she keeps bothering me. Otherwise, there will be no end to her coming here and embarrassing me.' The Lord said, 'Listen to what the unjust judge says. Won't God provide justice to his chosen people who cry out to him day and night? Will he be slow to help them? I tell you, he will give them justice quickly. But when the human one comes, will he find faithfulness on earth?" The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated.
You join with me in a spirit of prayer. Oh, Holy Spirit, either through me or in spite of me, let us hear the word this day. Pour out what you would say to us. Pour out love, courage, faithfulness. May we, as your disciples, have the passion and enthusiasm and love of Christ that those earliest followers did. In the name of Jesus, amen. There are certain items that most of us think of as standard party gear for milestones like graduations and pregnancies or baby showers and birthday celebrations. We actually in our family recently celebrated our oldest kid's birthday, and we have kind of a tradition of how we do this. In the morning, and actually my mother started this many years ago, and it's not the best tradition. It's kind of one of those that you kind of, lower your head and look away. But we serenade the birthday person. And I wish I could say that we sounded like the band at our house and the vocals that we have here at church, but we don't. And so we serenade the birthday person early in the morning. And then we tell the birthday story of what happened, how that day unfolded, what led up to it. During the festivities, I like to put up a special decoration on our front door. We have a happy birthday cutout of a cake that we hang up. For the party, we might start with a special favorite dinners. Anybody have favorite dinners that, like my sister cooks us favorite dinners? My mom used to do that when she was still alive. And then we have cake and ice cream, or sometimes the birthday person likes pie better or cupcakes or whatever, on festive plates. There might be balloons, there might be streamers, and then, there's always gross birthday cards, right? Especially when you get to a certain age. Some family and close friends might come over to our house, and Aunt Karen always mails the birthday person at our house her special iced sugar cookies all the way from Oregon. And when that package comes, you know what's in it. Well, today is actually a birthday. It's our birthday. And it's the birthday of Christians. We comprise the body of Christ. It's the body of Christ's birthday. And I don't have cake and ice cream, but I do have some bread and wine later that we can all partake of. I also have the birthday story that we usually read from Acts. In that story, we read how the Holy Spirit was poured out upon Jesus' remaining followers after his death, resurrection, and his ascension. Up to that point, don't forget how the disciples had stalled. There was no organized Christian movement, not after the ascension even. Then, as Jesus' followers were waiting in an upper room, The scripture says that all of a sudden a sound came from heaven like a strong wind, filling the house where the disciples had gathered. And they were filled, all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them the ability to speak. So the diverse gathering of Jews who had come to Jerusalem for the Shabbat celebration experienced the Spirit all at the same time. I mean, wow. All these different people, different ethnicities, from so far away, they could now understand one another in spite of a wide array of languages that were spoken. Not only that, there was a visible flame, we're told, a tongue of fire resting above the head of each person, a sign of the expected baptism by fire and the Spirit, not just water, remember. We're told to expect both baptism by fire and Spirit, not just water. Following these dramatic and unifying events, Peter then, bumbling, rock-headed Peter, preached the sermon of his life in which he announced the fulfillment of the promise of the prophet Joel. And I want to read the beginning of that. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit. What happens next is that Peter's sermon draws some 3,000 people to this young, fledgling, rather at this point disorganized group, and they begin to get prepared and organized for ministry to support one another and those in need. We get to see in that second chapter of Acts the birth of the church, the birthday story. And it's a wonderful day to recount, and it is a wonderful success story. As a pastor, I love this story. I love this story. What an amazing result the early church received from the gift of the Holy Spirit. But here's the deal. Reading that 3,000 people joined after one sermon is something hard for me to imagine. Maybe I need to go to preaching school a little more. Thinking about fire and gale winds stirred up in the people by the presence of the Holy God, and what passion those early disciples felt. When have we seen that? When have we experienced that passion? Well, don't feel alone if you haven't seen anything like that. As the years went by and the gospel stories were written down, apparently the members of Luke's faith community felt exactly the same way. They were discouraged. They were let down. They needed some signs that God was still listening and still involved. I mean, where was Jesus? Wasn't he coming back? You see, the time Luke is writing his story of Jesus is about 20 or more years down the road past Jesus' resurrection, past the time when he was with his disciples, and since the early church had begun. That all seems like history. And what's still going on? Rome. Rome is still the occupying power. Rome is still oppressing the weak and Christians now. Rome is still undefeated. The powers and principalities still reign. So Luke was writing to people, his community, who felt vulnerable, who felt defeated, and so he told them today's parable, a parable that I'm sure he remembered that the disciples had shared. It is a story about not giving up, about continuing to pray, even when the world is not as you hope, even when Rome is still oppressing, even when you're not sure when Jesus is coming again. As a mother, a parent, and as a Christian, as a person who believes we should be stewarding well the resources we are given in this life, I have got to admit that this week I have been absolutely dismayed by some of the world news. As the president was preparing to make a decision, an announcement about whether or not the USA would stay in the Paris Climate Agreement, I read a lot of science, read a lot about climate change. I read varying political opinions on this particular deal, pros and cons. Read what other countries were doing, not doing. I noticed in the midst of the whole conversation that a congressman stated that whatever happens to our earth, even if climate change is real, even if humans do have an impact, even if it might hurt the earth, God will take care of it. He implied we have no responsibility. Today's parable is about relentless prayer. And any of us can spot the theme as soon as we read the opening lines of the passage. I mean, it's right there, staring us in the face. Luke plainly tells us Jesus was telling them a parable about their need to pray continuously and not be discouraged. If we leave this story's meaning to that one sentence, then we can simply say that we are to pray always and say that with me. We are to pray always and not lose heart. We are to pray always and not lose heart. Okay, well, I might as well sit down because y'all got it, right? I mean, Luke announces it. There it is. This type of constant prayer could apply, of course, to our personal concerns. For example, a desire for a cure, a new job with better benefits, a life partner, or that our kids, who may be shaky, are going to be okay. However, it's clear that this parable is about a particular kind of prayer. It's not about our personal prayers, but about vindication. Or another way to say it, justice. Justice for those whose needs are not being met in our society. When we are dealing with corrupt humans who have no interest in justice, as some of the early Christians experienced under Rome, then Luke shares the story that Jesus once told, the story of the judge who doesn't fear God or even respect people. What must we say about this politician? Clearly, he wielded power and brokered influence. Likely, the judge kept his position by keeping people happy, yet he doesn't even take the judgment of God seriously. All those facts are right out there in the story. What must we do when we begin to lose heart, when we feel like the early Christians did, wondering when Jesus is going to fix the world, wondering when Rome's brutality will be stopped and injustice will cease? Here's what we do. We act like a widow. We act like a widow who has been denied justice by an unjust judge. Well, none of us knows through this story what justice this widow was denied, but we can imagine. She's a widow, first of all, and that means she has some kind of need. When you see the word widow in the Old Testament or in the New, think, help! Vulnerable group. As a woman, she cannot inherit her dead husband's estate. But it should help sustain her. That's the law. That's the law. So perhaps her sons have refused to let her live off of it. Or maybe a son-in-law has tried to cheat her. Or maybe someone else is wrangling to take away her rights. Whatever the case, this widow is desperate, vulnerable, and weak. It would be easy for her to give up. But the text is clear. The story is clear. Luke is clear. She continues to pester, asking the judge to give her justice against her adversary. Well, we're told the judge finally gives in. His reason? He says something quite humorous that we can't detect in our English translation that is in the Greek original. The judge says, "Though I don't fear God or respect people, yet, because this widow keeps bothering me, I will grant her justice so that she may not wear me out with continued blows under the eye." So that she may not wear me out with continued blows under the eye. This woman ain't just knocking at the door. She's hitting him hard. Can you imagine the press asking the questions to the judge about his black eye? He can't get rid of her. This judge doesn't want the whole town to know he can't get rid of her because of her constant badgering and her yelling at him. And while the judge cared about what other people thought, important people, the widow didn't. And perhaps she felt proud that she had stood up to such a bully. That is how the parable ends. But Jesus still has two questions for his listeners. And we are the listeners today. The Lord said, "Listen to what the unjust judge says. Won't God provide justice to his chosen people who cry out to him day and night? Will he be slow to help them? I tell you, he will give them justice quickly." Jesus, in summary, assures us that it is God's intention to grant vindication or justice for everyone. But here's the kicker, folks. Granting justice, practicing vindication for others, is not just on God, is it? The final question Jesus asks us is, "But when the Son of Man comes, will he find faithfulness on earth?" You hear that? But when the Son of Man comes, will he find faithfulness on earth? The work of justice for others is not only the job of God, but the responsibility of God's stewards and certainly Jesus' followers. That's us. Let's go back to the congressman. I'm picking today. The congressman who believes that if there is a problem with climate change for which humans are responsible, God will fix it. This is not the only time I've heard that kind of comment. I've heard other politicians and other even Christian leaders say that, and it's horrible theology. It's awful theology. That is not what our scripture said. God doesn't want justice not to be given nor even delayed, but Jesus clearly tells us that our own faithfulness in responding to injustice is part of God's solution. I can get fairly discouraged about a world that seems full of injustice. I have four little children. Well, they're not as little as they used to be. 11-year-old and three who are 8. And then I multiply all the other children in my community, in my state, in my nation, and around the world. And I can get really discouraged about their future. Of course I'm concerned about climate change because I believe that all children are our children and we have a responsibility to take care of what God gives us. I am also, frankly, concerned that an entire local school district, the LRSD, in which my children are enrolled, continues to be bogged down with administrative, political, and financial issues when children right now, today, need a good education. Today, not sometime later. It's sometimes overwhelming to think of the kids who are hungry or without beds. We recently bought a bed for a family right here through the Compassion Center so that three children would have a bed to sleep in. We have kids right here, hungry, without beds, without families, who need bread and homes and love. It's scary also to think that guns are hurting vulnerable people, even bystanders, young and old. Who, in this environment, who doesn't want to pull the covers over your head? I understand that. Who doesn't feel futile or tired or burdened by the work of these big problems? Who doesn't simply want to put a rag over one's head and lay down and forget faithfulness of which Jesus speaks? Who is tired and feels like quitting? We could ask those questions and keep waiting and waiting. Waiting. Or we could start knocking. We could keep pestering and knocking and bugging people about the unjust people and systems that we see around us so that our God, when our God comes, that God will find faith. Right here, right here on our earth. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Of mercy, when not kings and lords but nations, not thrones and crowns but men, flowers of thy heart, O God, are they? Let them not pass like reeds away their heritage, a sunless day. God save people. Shall crime be crime forever, strength aiding still the strong? Is it thy will, O Father, that man shall toil for wrong? Oh no, say thy mountains, no, say thy skies, man's clouded sun shall brightly rise. Instead of sighs, God save the people. When wilt thou save the people, O God of mercy? When The people are the people, not thrones and crowns, but men. Oh God, save the people, for thine they are, thy children as thy angels fear. Save the people from despair. God, save the people. Save the people, O God of mercy, when the people are the people, not thrones and crowns, but men. O God, save the people, for thine they are, thy children as thy angels fear. Save the people from despair. God, save the people. God, save the people. God, save the
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of heaven and earth. In the beginning, your spirit moved over the face of the waters. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. Your spirit came upon the prophets and teachers, anointing them to speak your word. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy is the Lord.
Holy, holy is the Lord.
Baptism in the Jordan, your spirit descended upon him and declared him your beloved son. With your spirit upon him, he turned away the temptations of sin. Your spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always, baptizing us with the Holy Spirit and with fire as on the day of Pentecost. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, O God, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus likewise took the cup, gave thanks to you, O God, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Spirit on each one of us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood and empowered by the gifts of the Holy Spirit. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, showing forth the fruit of the Spirit until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Together the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite our servers forward and make sure that everyone knows that this is Jesus' table. It belongs to him, and in the United Methodist Church, it is an open table, and all are welcome, coming with loving and forgiving hearts. When you receive the gifts via intinction from your steward, it is always appropriate to hold your hand out. They place the bread in, and you receive the grace, the gift, and then to dip it into the cup through intinction. And it's always appropriate to say thanks be to God or amen when you receive this amazing gift and reminder that the Spirit of God is with us always.
Thank you.
One of my favorite things about Pentecost are the symbol of the fire and the passion and the energy and the wind and the movement that it instills in us to think about in the church, the power of God at work in the church, moving us and energizing us. And so this day, if you don't have a church home, I want to encourage you next week to go to our Membership Matters class. It's a couple of hours, but we feed you and you get an opportunity to ask questions if you're unfamiliar with the United Methodist tradition. But we would love to walk with you on your journey. This is a wonderful community of faith. I always say we're not looking for more members on our rolls. We've got a lot of those. We are looking for people to bring justice to the world. And we want you to be a part of that. As we stand and sing our closing hymn, brothers and sisters, let us do that.
Justice and joy.
program at St. Luke. It has begun. It's not too late to volunteer, both on Mondays and Thursdays. This says 4:30. I think it's 5:30. Does anybody know for sure? I think. Yeah. My note says 4:30, but it's 5:30 to 6:30. So just 1 hour. Hope you'll try to come by this week. Even if you don't know what to do, we'll show you. Okay. So we can use hands. And we have a pop-up Sunday school that is starting June 18th and 25th. I know Rod's teaching that, and it's going to be Executing Grace, Shane Claiborne's book. Shane was here back in the fall. There's been a lot of conversation, of course, in our country about the death penalty, so that's what that book is actually about. So if you don't have a Sunday school class, we'd love for you to attend that and get a chance to read a great book. Will you receive this blessing? Go forth and love God and your neighbor in all that you do. Bear witness to the love of Jesus Christ so that those who do not know that love will find in each and every one of us most treasured and generous friends. In the name of Christ, amen.